everyone, Reed here. Welcome to a gameplay video here on channelfireball.com. Today I'm playing Alchemy, and the deck I have in front of me is Orzhov Venture, as in Venture into the Dungeon. This is the deck that my teammates and I settled on for the Neon Dynasty Championship, which in all likelihood, that event will take place in between my recording of this video and its publishing. So maybe you'll have the opportunity to have seen how my teammates and I did in that event. But this is just a well-rounded white-black colored mid-range deck, and a lot of the Adventure into the Dungeon stuff is buffed in Alchemy, so I'm excited to show you what it can do. My plan is that I'm going to commit to 5 matches on the arena ladder. Before I get to that, I want to give a shout-out to the Channel Fireball Marketplace, which is a great place to shop. And if you do decide to use the Channel Fireball Marketplace, please consider using my affiliate code Reed. And thanks also to Ultimate Guard for sponsoring me and my content. Ultimate Guard is unveiling tons of new products and variations on existing products this year, so I encourage you to stay tuned to their online catalog or Twitter account to see if anything's a good fit for you. Thanks for listening. Let's get some matches. Okay, this is a pretty unexciting hand, but I think it's keepable. Basically just missing a threat. Let's see what I'm up against. Naya Runes. This is the matchup we sort of designed the Orzhov deck to beat, which is not to say that you can't lose or anything. The Runes deck is extremely scary, but 4 main deck Archons of Emyria with lots of removal and discard spells is a pretty good way to neutralize the threat of the Runes deck. By the way, I drew just Stone Cold, the best card I could have drawn for turn 2. Turns my hand from like a 5 out of 10 to a 9 out of 10. Turn 1 Duress, turn 2 Adventurer. Now even the turn 3 Humiliate. Let's do that. Always default to the Lost Mine of Phandelver. And this looks like a hand where I should keep the Hagra Mauling. I'll take the goblin. And then, yeah, I'll keep the Hagra Mauling again. Kind of tempted to get it out there so I can start attacking with Hive of the Eye Tyrant, but let's prioritize killing all my opponent's stuff before firing up the creature land. All right, well, All those lands are well suited up. All right, my opponent, I guess, drew too many lands. They're fed up. The Nadara was going to seal the deal anyway. Right, so sideboarding against runes. This is a case of a matchup where there's definitely more than 60 cards that are appealing. So you got to make some tough calls. Yeah, usually this is my default, especially on the draw. On the play, Precipitous Drop could be better than Blood Chief's Thirst, just for that pattern of, like, I don't know, killing their generous visitor on turn two. Could see trimming the Valky, could see trimming the fourth Nadar. But for the most part, this is about where I want to be. Could see tripping the second Vanishing Verse. But this card is really good against Kami of Transience if they have that. So I'm going to go with this for game number two. Think this is a keep. It could definitely go badly if either my opponent's way too fast or if they have an answer to the Archon of Emeria. Well, now they need two answers. I guess I'll call white with that in case I draw Hive of the Eye Tyrant. Sure. So there is some consideration for Tamiyo's safekeeping to maybe main phase Vanishing Verse, the Generous Visitor. But what I like about this situation is my opponent can't really feel comfortable enchanting one of their creatures with an aura because I could hypothetically have an instant speed removal spell and fizzle the aura, fizzle the rune. So I think unless you know they have Tamiyo's safekeeping, you're usually going to be better off waiting and using your removal at instant speed. So it can definitely be case by case. It's a tricky question. All right, well, I imagine I'm going to play the Archon and it's going to get borrowed timed, but not really much I can do about that. I do have ways to kill the borrowed time and free up the Archon if I draw into them later. All right. Try again with the Archon. Well, I mean, my opponent can't cast a spell, so I think the only thing they could be representing is Iganjo, but I don't really believe that they have multiple copies of Iganjo in the three-color deck. Feels like just a mistake or a bluff or something. We'll see. Okay, very good. So how about play the adventurer, pass with three mana open. Can even attack for two. Sure. I think I'm still going to march the naturalist. It does remove three enchantments from the battlefield, which makes Katilda much less threatening. Could I actually go for the Mad Maze here? Because I just have so much venture. Nah, let's stick with the Lost Mine, because one of the things about the Mad Mage is it gives you the ability to cast spells for free, which is severely weakened when you have Archon of Emyria on the battlefield. Goblin. Venture into the dungeon. That's pretty close between drain for one or add a counter. I guess I'm just afraid of investing more into one of my creatures and then having it killed or being unable to attack with it. Nice. So Vanishing Verse can either kill Katilda or free up an Archon. Note that the goblins are 2/2s because of Nadara's ability. Okay, so a lot of times what I like to do is respond to my opponent's first spell by freeing up the Archon. Or this is an ambush possibility, because I can free up an Archon. That's going to shrink Katilda to 2-2, and then the Archon's going to be a 3-4 with Nadar. So opportunity to just get a free block, and I think my opponent's going to have a hard time from here. You can see how the venturing, the value you get from venturing into the dungeon just accumulates, like going through all these dungeons multiple times, multiple extra cards. Just like we drew it up. I'll be back for round two. Okay, welcome back. Match number two is Alchemy Orzhov Venture. This hand looks fine. Forsaken Crossroads for green. So, could be just another runes player, we'll see. More like Gruul, Werewolves. Here's the drop. I think having a lot of precipitous drops sets you up pretty well for these creature matchups. That's another card that's awesome in the creature matchup, so I'm going to top her. Something to look forward to on turn five. Right, so I think I should play Nadar, but yeah, okay, so I could play Nadar and then Valky plus Igonjo is an option for next turn. Could also make a treasure and just try to accelerate out the Forgotten Archangel. There's a lot of options here. But yeah, let's play this on white. Make a treasure. I'm predicting on a future turn being able to Igonjo for like one or two mana is going to be very powerful. Ouch. All right, so the drop plus an attack allows me to finish a dungeon. So drop on the Tovalar, drain for one life, attack, draw a card. At what point do I want to get Valky in there? So Valky first. So what else could I do? I could throw a counter on the Valky. Is that better than draining for one life? Almost certainly, right? Oh, no. Sorry, I don't have access to the counter mode. but I could shrink something. I'll just make the drain play. So now finish the dungeon. The Tovalar dies as a result. I think I'm actually fine just trading here, though I could Iganjo to wind up saving the Nadar. I think I'm okay with this. So if I was to Iganjo there, I would lose both of my mana sources and then maybe not be able to cast the Forgotten Archangel. Speaking of losing mana sources. So I was on the draw this game. So now I'm guessing my opponent's going to try to do Ranger class and attack and make this a 5-5, but I can respond to the Ranger class trigger and kill it. Remember, two legendary creatures looking good here. Oh man, two mana, kill a dragon at a profit. You love to see it. Yeah, seems good. All right, my opponent's seen enough. Love it. So bringing in a couple extra removal spells, and then Graveyard Trespasser is not like a amazing card in the matchup, but it's definitely better than Archon of Emyria. Sorin's not very good. Don't love Valky here. I don't love Duress. So I think that's the sort of default configuration. Depending on whether or not I draw land, I may play Hagra Mauling on turn one. Given that I drew Basic Swamp, I think I'll keep the Mauling. This card can be pretty sick because you get to cast it for 3 mana a lot in this format. And that's a pretty big difference, you know. 4 mana versus 3 is the difference between a very inefficient removal spell and the type of split card double face land that you're really excited about. Okay, probably attacking and then killing Tovalar with Power Word Kill. Probably good enough. So if I top that, then maybe I just play the Mauling as a land to make sure I have enough time to deploy all my spells. And I'm going to main phase the Power Word Kill because I find this matchup goes a lot more smoothly if it never becomes Knight in the first place. I'm attacking, I'm making the goblin. Then I'm going to play City Stalker Connoisseur, which by the way, it does have Death Touch. So my opponent will have to, do some work to be able to attack through that. And even then I have the goblin as a chump blocker. Got the Brittle Blast, and it looked like my opponent just didn't have any choice about that. So that means they probably have some cheaper cards in hand. Yeah, I'll go ahead and block. Sure. Okay, so let's make a 4/4 Nadar. Hopefully there are no more Thundering Rebukes to be had. Yeah, all right. It's going well so far. Hi, welcome back to match number 3 with Orzhov Venture. Okay, thinking about if this hand is enough below average to be a mulligan. I think it's a marginal keep. I would throw this one back if I was on the draw, but on the play, it's enough. You know, that should be enough time for the Hagra Mauling to be a relevant spell. So not super excited about this hand, but I did decide to keep it just based on having a good mix of lands and spells. Inclined to bottom that. I mean, it depends. If Nadar survives, then I can be venturing through the dungeon and getting treasures and drawing cards and maybe work my way up to Tibalt. But if the Nadar gets killed, then I just really want to find another threat or source of card advantage. Okay, it kind of feels like an Iganjo, something along those lines. May as well start with Duress, right? Yep. Take Wandering Emperor and actually Coast is clear to attack. Actually, it really doesn't matter what I take here because my opponent's going to Divine Purge next turn anyway. Feels like I'm supposed to keep the Hagra Mauling for these Cultivator Colossuses. So just gonna pass with Wandering Emperor. I think I'm in a bit of trouble here. Need to find City Stalker Connoisseur, Humiliate.
I've learned much during my travels. Let your blade do the talking. This fight.
Mulch, interesting. So because of the Iganjo, I'm just going to let the Wandering Emperor die and play a new one end of turn.
Back to wandering. Anyone who harms my people must contend with me. You are not much of a roadblock.
Go plus one counter.
Show them how we greet our enemies.
Plus one counter. Now it can attack into the Iganjo. I gotta find a way to steal this one, so it's. I mean, if my opponent now plays Cultivator Colossus, I should be able to just kill it and win the game. Which means they have to play Divine Purge. And then I start trying to rebuild again. Oh no! The Dark costs 7 now? All right, so I'm trying to put the most power and toughness onto the battlefield as possible, and then I'm going to march the Druid class in response to Cultivator Colossus. I mean, maybe if my opponent just never finds an answer to the flying Archon of Emyria. Here I'm gonna Hagra Mauling the Cultivator, add a counter to the Archon, attack for 5. And then we'll see what happens from there. Okay, not playing Igonjo. Okay, that's the one spell you had to cast. Not enough mana to activate Cave and block. Care about that? I don't think I care about that.
Remember your training.
That's not good.
Try not to miss me.
All right, I think I'm ready to throw in the towel. So for game two, all the discard spells are coming in. Sorin's coming in. Imagine Graveyard Trespasser is good enough. So here's the 56 cards I like, and then I'm going to have to include some cards that I don't particularly like. March or Bloodchief Thirst, these cards are definitely fine. the two thirsts and the two angels, maybe? The Archon is, in theory, is not that bad, but if my opponent keeps in a bunch of Divine Purges, it's just pretty lame. Doesn't put on a very fast clock. Yeah, I mean, if I hit even one land, it's virtually perfect. Huh. So now I can't even necessarily cast Humiliate on turn two. Scry bottom. Come on, give me a land for turn three. No. Wow. Do I attack into Iganjo or wait? I mean, waiting's bad if they have some kind of board sweeper. The goal. I think I'll attack. Going to attack and add a counter to the goblin token. And then Sorin and start plussing.
Violence is necessary to set things right. My ways are not for the weak. Nothing on Innistrad is free.
Nice! Good hit with the City Stalker. Name Red just in case I... Oh, yeah, there's the Tibalt. All right, that's a plan. That's a plan. So I imagine the Frost Dragon start attacking Sorin to keep him off of Ultimate. Hmm. Man, I have this feeling my opponent drew Shigeki. They're gonna get Cultivator Colossus and Fateful Absence. Well, City Stalker is a really good
Your
hit if
time
that's what's
calls
going
for
on
dire
here.
tactics.
Oh, I was wrong. Just mulch. Okay, then I'm passing. No need to attack the goblin into the creature land.
Can I help? My ways are not for the not gone.
All right, game three. Any changes based on what I saw? Do I feel like I want to get the Archangels out or the Blood Chief Thirsts out? I didn't see Divine Purge in that post-sideboard game. I think I'm going to stick with what I have. Sure. At least a solid curve of creatures, even though I don't have disruption. Oh no, can I take that Blood Chief's Thirst back? Maybe I can try to snag Shigeki with Valky. Yeah, I think I'm on board with drawing that. the Sharn, Mulch, Dryad's Revival. So now Trespasser or Nadar. I think I'm going to try Nadar. Not what I was hoping to see. So I took away the Faithful Absence, then I exiled the Dryad's Revival. We'll see if the Graveyard Trespasser winds up sticking on the battlefield. So Forgotten Archangel actually has multiple relevant abilities here. I'm going to attack with the Graveyard Trespasser. If my opponent chooses to trade with the Legion Angel, the Legion Angel will be exiled, and the Graveyard Trespasser will wind up back in my hand. So basically, the Forgotten Archangel is like, you have to kill this first before you kill any other of Reed's creatures. Scry top, that's terrifying. Ouch. Well, I can use Valky to get rid of Shigeki for the time being. And then Graveyard Trespasser, the Divine Purge. Okay.
They prepare for war.
Alright, I'll play a couple Triumphant Adventurers. At least they have Death Touch. Wow! Hit four lands? That's too many. Man, I'm fighting hard, but I don't know if I'm gonna be able to overcome all this value. Interesting. I thought my opponent would try to prioritize freeing up the Shigeki, but they went with Iganjo. Okay, so we're gonna do Trespasser at Ren, these two at player. I'm gonna drain for one. And then I'm going to pass the turn, and I have a cool trick that I can do, which is if my opponent tries to Divine Smite the Valky, I can just turn it into Shigeki, and then it'll be a green creature instead of a black creature. The forest will be overrun. It's also going to become Knight, which the Graveyard Glutton is extremely powerful. That's not good. That is really not good. I think I have to do this. I'm gonna activate Valky right now. before anything else happens. Okay, now I have a green creature. Not worried about Divine Smite anymore. Now I'll flash in the Emperor.
Feel the energy of battle. Bring down like water. I am almost sad to see you go.
Okay, adventurer attacks. Gets exiled. I draw a card. Yeah, okay. That's a plan if I can survive that long. That's it for the Legion Angels. Oh my god. Make another 15-15. If I take it, I go to 2. Then I exile it, I go to 4. I attack, I go to 6. Can make one of these angels unable to attack. I think I probably have to block with the Graveyard Glutton. Especially because of the Cave of the Frost Dragon. Although I can Power Word kill the Cave of the Frost Dragon. So let's count this again. I take it, I go to 2. I exile it, I go to 4. I attack, I go to 6. Then these angels attack me and that kills me. So yeah. What happens if I block with Valky? Then the Shigeki goes back to hand. But that might actually be manageable. Is this better? No, can't be better.
My judgment is fine. will have much to do. I am almost sad to see you go.
Now, because this says non-angel creature, I think I'm actually just dead if my opponent pluses on a Legion Angel and attacks with those two. So I have to hope they make some different play.
I have got new moves to teach you.
Angel Warrior, target non-angel. Yeah, nothing to be done here. I was gonna be able to return Shigeki and play it as Valky if the game went long enough, but just not, couldn't quite hang with all that value. Okay, I'll be back. All right, welcome back to match number 4, Alchemy Orzhov Venture. Name white. I guess that's fine. Just curve 2, 3, 4. Funny, all four of my opponents have had Forsaken Crossroads calling green, though they could potentially all be playing very different decks. Yeah, I can work with that. I guess I'll make a token. Okay, this deck looks definitely closer to the Cultivator Colossus deck that I just lost to. All right, I'm gonna attack, get a counter and draw a card. And then probably I wanna just pass with the Wandering Emperor. Because they could have a board sweeper, let's say, begin anew. But the problem is there's no guarantee that the City Stalker Connoisseur would even hit that if I cast it. So being able to potentially rebuild with Wandering Emperor is, I think, my best bet. So here I can basically just make a Samurai, then I have Lethal. Yep. All good. I think I'll sideboard more or less the same way I did last time. Though, I took out the marches against the previous opponent, but they are really good against Ren and Seven tokens. So those are fine cards to keep in the deck. Should go with 1 and 1 this time. 1 angel, 1 march. Just need lands. Definitely don't need my third copy of the legend. That lands. I can play this untapped since I was on the draw. March of Otherworldly Light is also good against Portable Hole for what that's worth. Look at the top seven cards of your library. Put up to two land cards from among them onto the battlefield. We have the World Tree. Take the goblin. What is this foretold card? It could be a Doomscar, it could be Starnheim Unleashed. I guess I'll give credit that it could be a Doomscar, and I'll pass with the Wandering Emperor. Wow, playing Emiria's Call. And here's the Prismatic Bridge. Beginning of your upkeep, reveal cards from top of your library until you reveal a creature or planeswalker card. Put that card on the battlefield and the rest on the bottom. Yeah, I mean, that's not even close to being able to Vanishing Verse that. I could Vanishing Verse the Portable Hole.
I've learned much during my travels. Sure. Keep watch for intruders. Remember your training.
Shigeki. All right, so they do have Doomscar. They have the Kami War. All right, let's get back the Adventurer. Discarded Emiria's Call.
Let your blade do the talking. You started this fight.
Okay, so Wandering Emperor hits the battlefield. That was end of turn Kyodai. One card remaining in hand.
Back to wandering.
Well, I guess I should see if the coast is clear, right? It's Igonjo. So the coast is not clear. Can't kill Kyodai with power word kill. I think I just attack with everything and play another adventurer. Also attack Wandering Emperor with everything. City Stalker down. Emperor down. So now my opponent has no cards. I feel like most of the things they can hit with Prismatic Bridge, as long as they brick on the draw step, I'm going to be in decent shape. All right, so there's a lot of ways I can assemble lethal here. I mean, basically, I'm going to play a Lord. I'm going to kill Shigeki. And then with three more ventures, can drain for one life. All that stuff's good. Is it lethal? I think it is exactly lethal. So I'm going to drain for one life down to six, and then any two creatures that get through will be six damage in combat. Just limping over the finish line, but we take those. Hello, welcome back to the fifth and final match of today's video. Currently 3-1 with Orzhov Venture. Let's try to end it on a good note. Well, hand is more keepable than it initially looks because I do have Hagrim Mauling as a land. I think it's actually reasonable. Like, three draw steps to find a land, and then I have a duress, a removal spell, and a good threat. It's not a beautiful hand, but I think it's keepable. Not the hand I was hoping for against Mono White. We still might be okay. Let's stick with the plan. It's good I get to practice this matchup because Mono White's the most played deck in the metagame breakdown for the Neon Dynasty Championship. too slow to humiliate. Sure. Play an Archon, hoping to just trade it against the Spellbinder. Really not loving my options. Okay, I guess that's pretty good. Is it though? All right, so I'm gonna Precipitous drop the Legion Angel. Then my opponent's gonna attack me for 4 damage and play another Legion Angel. Then what? Then I probably need to play the Nadar. Make it a 4/4. And I'm just going to need to find removal. I don't think I can afford the City Stalker. I think I'm a little bit too far behind for that. So I'm kind of assuming that my opponent will Skyclave the Nadar. Yeah, it's equivalent. It's actually better for me because now I can free up the Nadar and get another venture. We'll finish the dungeon. My opponent could have destroyed Precipitous Drop in response. That would have been a good play. Yep, no blocks. Yes. Probably not much I can draw here. City Stalker. Play two creatures and still be dead. Depending on how aggressive the version of White Weenie, I found that Dawnbringer Cleric sometimes is just okay as a 1-3 that gains 2 life. The Archons are bad. Valky's pretty bad. The discard spells are bad. So yeah, I guess it's kind of like, do I want Dawnbringer or do I want Valky? I'm on the play, and my opponent looked like they were maybe a slightly more grindy or more mid-rangey version of Mono White, so I'll go with the Valky. Could also be Humiliate, but let's try this. Okay, much better. This is a good hand to have on the play, too. On the draw, you probably want to be killing creatures, but on the play, just deploying your own threats is pretty good. All right, this is a good anti-Thalia hand, too. Just all creatures. Not sure what my opponent should take, but I hope that I get to make a play to the board next turn. Probably the worst case scenario for me is if my opponent chooses to take Graveyard Trespasser and then I draw another expensive card. Although there's not that many uncastable cards from this position. Right, so seems like attacking and putting a counter on Nadar is a good idea. Am I desperate to kill this? Am I fine to just play Graveyard Trespasser? I think I'm fine to just play another creature. I could also just venture again, but I think it's more important to add something to the battlefield. What to do here? So I don't hate the idea of just passing, then it gets to be knight, and then I have Hagar Mauling available. Oof, a bold attack. Discarded the Wandering Emperor. I could easily see my opponent having more copies of Wandering Emperor. In which case, do I want to just attack now? Because it's going to get only worse for me. Yeah, I guess I'll just offer the trade. Take my value up while I can get it. Okay, I don't think that changes anything for right now. I'm going to attack with the City Stalker and play the Adventurer. So I can technically present lethal next turn. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. But I'm not likely to have enough mana to remove a blocker and activate the hive in the same turn. Okay, so I'm just attacking with only the adventurer. And see what I draw. That's a great draw. That's a great scry. So against ground attackers, I have the 3-3 death touch, the 1-1 goblin, which trades up against one of these 3-1s, and I'm threatening to activate the hive. Against air attackers, I have the march, and if the turn goes sort of according to plan, where they just play the Legion Angel, I can probably just march that end of turn. But I think I'm gonna kill the Spellbinder. Yep. The reason Hive is a good attacker is it has menace, and it gets to kill any two creatures that block it. And more goblins. So assuming my opponent has nothing castable, that's something castable. Actually, lifelink's pretty huge here. I attack with Hive and Adventurer. And drain for one? Or do I put a counter on the adventurer? Let me scry first, actually. So if I had seen a blank there, like if I had scryed a land to the bottom, I might have elected to put a +1/+1 counter on the Triumphant Adventurer to prevent my opponent from being able to triple block and kill the adventurer. But since I had a good card on top, I feel like just taking my 2-for-1 trades with these creatures is enough, and I'll be able to win with the Wandering Emperor. So then I elected for the drain ability, which is going to force the Hive. Like, basically, my opponent's going to have to double block the Hive with Intrepid Adversary and Sigardian Evangel. Oh, actually, this is a really strong double block, too. I'm going to elect to kill the Angel. But now my opponent gets to, like, gain 3 life for free. That was smart. However, as long as his adventurer is attacking uncontested, I feel like the advantage that venturing every turn is giving me will be enough to win the game. But Inquisitor Captain into, say, Skyclave Apparition, that's definitely a game changer. That too. Man, I might be in trouble now. It's actually a sick draw, especially given that it's nighttime already, so double drain right off the bat.
My judgment is fine.
Still have me surviving at 1. Wow, what a miracle draw, the Graveyard Glutton. That is so sick. I thought I was definitely going to win. And then the Inquisitor Captain showed up. And then I thought I was definitely going to lose. And then the Graveyard Glutton showed up. Now, I have lethal regardless because I can just add a counter to the Hive. Or wait. The Hive traded in combat. Well, I guess the hits keep coming because this does give me lethal. Whew. That was only game 2. On the draw, I'm going to swap the Valky for the Dawnbringer Cleric because it matches up really well against Thalia, Sigardian Evangel, Intrepid Adversary, just like a good way to make sure I don't die to the early rush. Ooh, man. If you look at just the four cards of Black Land, White Land, Blood Chief's Thirst, Nadar, that's almost keepable. But I mean, there's the fail case of like, if I just don't draw a land in my first three draws. There's also, I mean, it is a good hand. It is a good hand if I draw a land in my top three, because it's resilient to Thalia. I'll have made two plays in my first three turns, which that's kind of the bar that I'm looking for. And then the scry gets me to my fourth land where I have some good stuff. So I think this is a borderline keep. All right, not a great start. Yeah, that's fine. I think I'm going to march that. Probably march exiling the other march. And then just try to grind it out with a connoisseur every turn. Looks like they're choosing between two cards of the same mana cost, right? Unless they put it in full control mode or something. Wandering Emperor and Legion Angel? Or Skyclave Apparition and Elite Spellbinder? You know, something like that. Ooh, Inquisitor Captain. So, I don't know. I mean, I guess that's representing Wandering Emperor, right? Just take it.
Coming off. Let your blade do the talking. I have got new moves to teach you.
What do you think? What do we think my opponent drew that they wouldn't cast it or attack with the Faceless Haven? Like, maybe I'm wrong. Well, maybe they thought if they attacked with the Haven, I could double block the Samurai and attack back. In any case, this is on white, by the way, so Meat Hook Massacre is not currently online. I think I'm gonna attack.
Watch for intruders. Remember your training.
My inclination is just to block. I guess I should block the Samurai with the Nadar. Because otherwise, I attack back, my opponent makes the same trade. Well, I guess it can go well for me if I draw. If I draw land for my Wandering Emperor, then I can attack and like kind of threaten to save Nadar. But I'm thinking if this trade happens soon later, I might as well just block now and save 3 life. Tapped land is not ideal. I definitely need my opponent to just draw planes for a few turns if I'm gonna make a comeback in this game. Like, needs to become nighttime as a result of my opponent making no play. Then I need to have Wandering Emperor probably kill the Hopeful Initiate.
We've got the edge in this fight.
So yeah, I could double block, or I could trade the Graveyard Trespasser. Yeah, I mean, I think that's right. Oh no, that one got first strike. But I could still double block the Initiate. Which is that good? I think I'm going to take the high upside play, which if it becomes nighttime, like that is a way for me to actually win this game. Okay, Faceless Haven. So it does become night. I get to attack and gain two and threaten the Wandering Emperor. If my opponent just lets the Emperor die, then I probably lose the game. But I also lose if I pass. If my opponent lets the Wandering Emperor die, then I think I need to use a blood and try to find like Nadar or Precipitous Drop. Actually, Precipitous Drop wouldn't do it. Just only Nadar or another Graveyard Trespasser, I think, are my outs here. So yeah, exile one attacker, go up to five, but then that's game. At least we got a great match to finish things out.
Anyone who harms my people must contend with me. I am almost sad to see you go.
Well, that's all I've got for today. I hope you enjoyed it, and I will see you next time. Thanks, everyone.